From Cars to Space, David, Macey and Michael Haas.
Thanks very much. Yep, I'm David, and we're talking about From Cars to Space. Firstly, just before I get started, I just want to say thanks very much for getting up on a Saturday morning and coming to see us. Really appreciate you giving up your lie-in to come in. I'm David, and I'm from Inc. I'm here with Mike, and we're going to be talking a bit about some of our work today. But just before I get started, I just want to say thanks to Chaos Group for inviting us here. It's a really cool event. It's the first time we've come here. But we've got a long connection with Sofia in Bulgaria. We have a sister studio we work with here called Art Ray. They've been with us since the beginning, and I just want to give a big shout out to them. And they're a great studio. They've been with us through the highs and the lows, and they do great work. So definitely check their work out as well. And some of the stuff you've seen today, they've been very much a part of. So what are we going to talk about today? Before we came down to the presentation, Mike and I talked about what we were going to chat about. And I think what we wanted to give you guys is a big overview of us as a studio, not get kind of drawn too much into the nitty-gritty of the technical side of things. Obviously, we do touch on the production pipeline and things like that, but we wanted to give you an overview of the studio, of what we do, a bit of from the creative side of things, from the production side of things, so you guys get a clear picture about everything. So, what do we do? Well, we're a creative production studio, and what I mean by that is we do CGI, we do animation, we do post-production, and we really cater for clients that kind of come to us with a brief, sometimes they have quite a loose brief, it's like, can you just make us something cool? Or sometimes they have a very kind of strict brief, and they give us mock-ups and things like that. Our content is distributed across social channels, YouTube, clients' websites. So we really do a little bit of everything. But where we really excel, where our strength is that we're great with the technical and the beautiful. And what I mean by that is that it could be a very complicated CGI animation, or it could be a beautiful retouch project that we've got to do. And that's what's special about Inc. as a company. We started in 2009, and myself and my friend Carmen, who's also Bulgarian, we used to work for a studio together, and we got made redundant. And I sunk the last of my savings into a computer that Carmen built. I thought it would be better to have a solid-state drive than pay my rent at the time. And we got our first job. It was a little animation, and we worked in a back street of the East End of London, producing this little animation together. And that's kind of like how we grew as a business. We did one project, and a client saw that and would get a phone call and say, can I have one of them? And that's how we've grown as a business. And today we've just moved into our new studio, and we've got a great team. And the team is a blend of lots of different talents. It's not just CGI artists. It's photographers, graphic designers, animators, English grads. It's a full spectrum of different talents. And again, that's what's special about the company. It's that blend of different people with different backgrounds that kind of contribute to the product and what we do. So it's not purely just on the CGI side of things. It's also on the creative side of things. And when we do a project, it's normally we put a team together that are both strong technically and strong creatively. And we find that when we put that together, that's when we get our best results. Obviously, V-Ray is a big part of our pipeline. It's a great product. It's probably one of the few bits of software that is involved with pretty much anything we do now these days. I mean, V-Ray has some sort of role in it, whether it's a quick mock-up or whether it's a big kind of complicated animation. So V-Ray is probably one of the most used pieces of software in the studio. So I'm just going to show you our showreel, and this is our automotive showreel, just before we get started. And that will kind of give you a taste of some of our animation work, and then I'll get into some of the things I'm going to talk about. So that's great for the Land Rover fans out there. But what I want to talk about today, and this is something we've not really talked about in some of our past presentations, and that's our workshop. Now, the workshop was something we created early on in the business, and it was really, the whole point of the workshop is it's a space away from the commercial part of the business. It's a space to play and have fun. The reason why we set it up was that we didn't want to lose sight of being curious about the software and curious about creativity. It's something that is important to us. Especially like when I first got into this business, I'd sit in my bedroom modeling, trying to render something, whether it be a computer speaker or a mobile phone, which is pretty much what everyone does when they first start doing 3D. And it's kind of not losing sight of that fact where you first start experimenting with a piece of software and you have the fun early on. And this is what the workshop is. It's a play space for us to just have fun and kind of experiment. So the first project I want to talk about is Dogfighters. This was the first thing we did as the workshop. And we're much more sophisticated these days. So, as I said, the workshop was a space to have fun. And it really came about that someone said in the studios, like, we haven't got any fur projects in our portfolio. And that's what kind of normally happens at Inc. Someone says, we haven't got this, or we haven't got that, we should do this. And then a kind of idea is born. And James, the art director at Inc., had this idea of a project called, it was called Cold War Pets at the time. So it was kind of 1960s. Jet aircraft dressed in kind of leopard skin print. And I think because we want to do something with fur, we felt that was a little bit, it wasn't kind of going to be tangible enough. It wasn't going to be tactile enough in terms of, the whole idea was that you better reach out and actually stroke these aeroplanes. So the idea developed, and I proposed the idea that they should be dogfighters and it should be Second World War and build on that idea. So as I went back to the, just going back to what I said at the beginning about being comfortable in the creative and the technical, this is a perfect example of that. So when we started the project, we had the idea, which was create these crazy planes covered in fur, and then we had to work out how we're going to do the fur. So we started developing like, well, how do you make a plane look like a dog, and what plane goes with what dog? And we had this idea of the Lancaster bomber was the first one. So we had a team developing the fur in terms of how we were going to do the fur, and then we had a team developing, adding, I guess, the dogness to an aeroplane, which is bizarre. And it came out really well. I mean, if you go online, I know there's we did a nice screen capture on how we created this from start to finish. It's somewhere, I think it's Photoshop tutorials or something. There's something online with from start to finish, from the 3D side of things, from the retouch side of things as well. So you can go online and watch that. But yeah, so we had a team doing the technical, doing all the fur, and then we had a team doing the creative, working out how to actually make the plane look like a dog. And it was really successful. I mean, we called this the Wellington Retriever. And then we had the biplane Schnauzer and the Spitfire Beagle. And we kind of got addicted to we're only going to do one, and we ended up doing three. And this, like, how can you make a plane like a dog? But it was really simple. We got really good at it at the end. You know, we'd pick a plane and we could easily relate that to a dog. And I think Mike's going to be talking about some of our Virgin Galactic work a bit later on. I think we had that as a Dalmatian, but we never finished that one. But just going back to this, started off as a bit of fun. Someone saying, let's do something with fur, and then someone having an idea. When we finished the project and we put it out to, you know, through Behance and through all our networks, you know, we then had a credit card company, a big credit card company, asking us to buy the rights for their airport campaign. So it stuck from what started as a little bit of curiosity, turned out into a big client asking us to buy the rights for it. And we never did the deal in the end, but it just goes to show, from that little bit of curiosity can turn into a live paying job. But we had a lot of fun. The whole idea is to have fun, get something out of it as a studio, and have something to show at the end of it. And again, we don't take ourselves too seriously as well. That's another thing. So the second project I'd like to talk about is Guide to Computing, and that's something we finished this year. Now, this is predominantly a retouch project, and so a little bit less about the, obviously, on the CG side of things. But I wanted to talk about it because it encapsulates what the workshop is about. And we are very passionate about anything engineering-wise. And obviously, coming up from the digital background, experimenting with 3D and post-production as growing up, there's a natural interest into computers. And this was an idea from James. And he had this idea of going back to all the old computers from the 50s and the 60s. I mean, a lot of the heritage and a lot of the history in terms of what we do today is based on these machines. So we were totally geeking out on these machines. But we also realized they're also really beautiful as well. You know, at the time, they were very functional. But now, when you look at them, they're really pretty. You know, these days, everyone's got a black box with a red light on it or something like that. But there's a certain amount of beauty to it. So he was working very closely with the Science Museum, Bletchley Park, in terms of getting access to these machines. Now, a lot of these machines were behind glass or in storage or very hard to access. We couldn't take them along to a nice studio, shoot them, or get them cleaned or anything like that. We had to go along, shoot them behind a glass cabinet, and then that's when the digital side of things began, because part of the project was return these machines back to their former glory digitally. And that was make them look brand new again, so they look totally clean, totally new. And we did a series of these computers, and it looks really simple when I show it on here now, but it took about 6 months to do them with about three retouch artists on it. So painstakingly rebuilding the shots, retouching them. And then, in terms of where V-Ray came into it, is that we then had to render the shadows in there. And so we'd mock up a little model of one of these computers and then render the shadow in there as well. It's a really simple use of V-Ray. It's not complicated, but it just goes to show the versatility, how, you know, maybe some of you guys out there using V-Ray wouldn't notice that obviously the shadows are rendered here. But to get the kind of quality of the shadow and what we wanted and to make it look exactly real, we just rendered it in there. And that goes back to, like, the studio of having these skill sets of retouchers, CGI artists. It really gives us the versatility to kind of tap into these different types of kind of production processes. So the good thing about when we do one of these projects is it's also part of our marketing tool, a showcase to what we can do. And when we finish the project, we then send it out to people, and this was particularly really successful because we got a double page in The Guardian, we got a big write-up on Wired, Creative Review did a really good article on it. New Scientist did a double page spread. And what's good about it is that when we start working with people, we're kind of exhibiting ourselves to an audience that we know will have things in common with us. So when we start getting commercial work in, they'll start looking at this and they'll see the things that we're into and then maybe give us the appropriate brief to go with that. So it's really a case of like reaching out, showing what we can do, and then meeting like-minded people. So again, a very small project turned out to be a big, I mean, if you were to buy all this coverage, it'll cost you thousands of pounds for advertising. But for us, it's about just doing great work, putting it out there, and seeing and meeting people in terms of who like our work. So the next project I'd like to talk about, this is a more of a CG project, is our Plane Body series. And the Plane Body series came about after a trip to Le Mans. I went to Le Mans and had a really cool time there. And just going back to some of these workshop projects, it normally relies on a bit of inspiration, something we're into. And I went to Le Mans and I came back and it was such a great time. I said, we should do something with Le Mans. You know, just do something on the automotive sector of the business. And this idea developed that we could do something with the Porsche 917. And it started a few years back now, what we did with the 917. And we just started doing some mucking around with some renders, doing some mock-ups in Photoshop. And this idea kind of developed to create a car that was just, you know, remove all the liveries, make it really clean, and just rely on the beauty, the form of the car. So, I mean, this is the D-Type. We've done a few now. In terms of the production process, how it works is that we either have a car on file or we model a car, and we spend about a month modeling a heap of detail into it. You know, just on this shot here, you see some of the detail that goes into it. And then we then kind of set a really nice set of compositions up, and we render it in a white, clean environment. It sounds really simple, but what's complicated about it is the detail that goes into it. So when you look at it, it looks simple at first glance, but if you look further into the image, you have like the bluing of the exhaust, the little bits of dirt around the wheel arch. And it's just something we do for some fun, but we do it every year now around Le Mans to celebrate iconic Le Mans vehicles. So we started off with the 917. We did the D-Type, and this year we've done the GT40. But it's funny with these workshop projects, because they tend to get a bit of, they start getting some following, like with the dogfighters and what we did with Guide to Computing. These have got quite a big following in with the car fans. And recently, we teamed up with Petrolicious, who are now selling the prints. And this workshop project, what turned out like, you know, we should do something with a Le Mans car, now turned out to be a poster series we sell on Petrolicious. And it just goes to show that, you know, from having some fun, a bit of curiosity, and then experimenting on the digital side of things can lead to something that then now brings us revenue. But the important thing, the reason why I want to show this project is that it introduced us to lots of different people. So I just want to wrap up my side of it. And hand you over to Mike, who's going to be talking to you a little bit about the commercial side of the business and some of our animation work.
I think it's on.
And he's going to come up now, I think. But like I said, if there's any questions at the end, I mean, we're going to be here all day. If, you know, Carmen's also here from the business, he's really good at V-Ray. So he's happy. We'll be happy to answer any questions. Come and speak to us. Come speak to me. I've got my cards with me. Introduce yourselves. Don't be shy. And I'll hand you over to Mike.
Hi, everyone, and thanks for having us today. And I also especially want to thank the Chaos Group for inviting us. It's an honor and pleasure to be here tonight. Not tonight, morning, really early morning. And basically, the second part of the presentation, I just want to pick up where Dave left it in space. And I'm wondering, like, did any one of you ever considered making holiday in space? So, wrong direction. $250,000 and you can get a ticket for that spaceship and go up. And the company who's providing it is Virgin Galactic, and you can buy the tickets now, and then in a couple of years when they're ready, you can fly up. But what they already have now is like the passion for adventure, which they're sharing with Land Rover. And that's also why they kind of teamed up with Land Rover and have got them as a media partner. And that's also like where we from Inc. came involved in the whole project. And for their launch of a new car, which is coming out, they have a previous car, which is the Vision Concept car, which they kind of did a really big media event in New York with, which you can see on the pictures. So they kind of hired an aircraft carrier, which they then kind of revealed the car and just made a really massive media event out of it. And for this event, they asked us to do a few assets, which was a package of images and some video films as well. And one of the films which we did, which I want to talk about, is like the trailer for this Vision Concept. So the thing about a trailer is like you don't want to show too much. You just want to give a hint of the car. So basically, you should show as less as possible and just focus on the main features. With this Vision Concept, it was like the infotainment system, the sunroof, and most important, the 5+2 seating, which basically just means it has 7 seats. So that's basically the car which we're not allowed to show from the outside, but we still had to make it teaser to get the people excited about, and we kind of came up with a film. But it's also like the first time we kind of like show this film, because like just after the launch of the Vision Concept, on one of the test flights, the spaceship crashed and the pilot died, and so we decided, out of respect for the pilot, we will just keep it a while off of the media. But now we want to share it with you.
Manager of the launch team wishes you good luck.
So are you ready to discover? One thing we really spent quite a bit of time on getting right is like the sounds on it, because we wanted to keep it as simple as possible. So you feel the space and the dramatic kind of feeling being outside in space and not like being kind of like overloaded by sound effects and unnecessary noise. And we were really happy that we were able to get like original sound recordings of a rocket launch, so the voice which is speaking, that's an original recording which we put on, which we were quite happy to get access to. The other thing, like what we kind of tried to figure out as good as possible, is like to find ways to show a little bit of the car but not showing too much. So like putting the interior of the car on the reflection of the helmet was a riot because it was distorted, so no one really could say what it is. It more was giving a hint that you're in a car. So techniques like that we kind of worked out to kind of like find a nice in-between between revealing things but not too much and still covering all the main assets that we need to show. Another technique which we use to give this feeling of space is like constant movements of the camera with no acceleration at the beginning or ending. It's just like a floating object in space, and using the shadows and light to kind of reveal the points of interest. One really thing we kind of had to argue with the agency about is like the end shot, because we really wanted to show the nice connection to Virgin Galactic, because that was also a brief part of the brief that we kind of need to show the link to the car to space. So we were like, all right, that would be really nice to show the key and the key fob of the Virgin Galactic little spaceship. But they were arguing like, well, it's a vision concept of a car. Do we going to have like a key in the future, or is it all like kind of access to the cars like differently. But at the end, we were allowed to do it where we're really happy about, because it's kind of like a strong element. And especially on that one, I was asked quite a few times, did we like animate that kind of movement, or is it a simulation? So I thought like, well, let's kind of make a little, let's see if it plays making off about it. So we started with simulating it, which gives a nice feeling of being weightless. Oops. But at the same time, we were losing a little bit the control of, just let's stop it quickly, of like the spaceship to the key itself, because it was kind of like twisting too much and it didn't really feel right yet. So we did a few tests, and at the end we just took a few chain elements out, so it's a bit more like dancing over the screen than like uncontrolled floating. And after we were happy with how it was moving, we moved on and kind of like plotted out the simulation, attached it to like an helper, and then put animation on top just to be sure that at the moment when it enters the frame, it is exactly where we are. And once it's rotating around, it kind of reveals the logo at the end exactly where we wanted it. So getting the nice weightless feel of the simulation, and then on top, taking the animation for the control of it. So that's like replacing the low-res geometry to the high-res, the low-res for the, to keep the sim quick. And then, yeah, rendering it out and comping it. So in terms of software packages, what we're using, it's as a 3D package, it's 3D Studio Max. Especially for that one, we used MassFX, the build in simulation tool of Max, and rendering in V-Ray, and comping, and was Nuke. I think to point out, it's really, really important to have like strong tools as a software package. But what sometimes is forgotten, it's even more important to have like good artists behind it doing it. And like Dave already mentioned, like we always like to work with the Bulgarian artists. You're really passionate guys, and you're doing an incredible job on it. And yeah, thanks for that. It's really, really good. I think just out of interest, like how many of you guys are using V-Ray? Can you just put up your hands? All right, quite a few. So I probably don't have to mention anything that it's a good software. You already know it. That's good. Right. So yeah, to cover it up, that's like the vision concept car from the outside, which we were not allowed to show in the trailer. And just a couple of weeks from the vision to the real discovery, that one came out, the orange one. It is slightly different, but they took quite a few elements from the vision now to the car you can buy. And for this kind of launch, we also were allowed to make a few assets and images and videos as well. And I want to kind of like talk about one which was especially fun. And it started on like doing the project and coming in on a Monday morning where everything is a bit crazy in the office. Everyone wants something from you. And just went into the office, sat down in my place and started watching dog videos. So, and like after like 50 minutes, when the first people come up, you say, sorry, Mike, we just need a few things from you. And you're like, no, can't be bothered. Need to watch more dog videos, at least. Maybe like another 10 or maybe even more. So what was it about? Like the engineers, when they were like designing the car, they kind of like thought about how the boot area should look so it's good for dogs as well. And because it's a good selling point, they wanted to have like one film asset just showing that they kind of like designed it for the pets as well. And what they really do at Land Rover, they have like a little dummy dog, which they put into the car and just see how it fits in. Well, that wouldn't be too exciting because it's quite static. So they asked us to do like a low poly version of the dog to put in and make like that as a film asset. So we didn't make the whole film. They just asked us to do the poly dog in their cut. So we were thinking about different ways to do it, and they only gave us a few seconds. And they said like the dog should move around and do different poses. So because it wasn't too long and we wanted to show as much poses as possible, we did like jump and decided to do jump cuts for it. And that worked out quite well. I would just show the film. I chopped off the beginning of the film because it's quite long. And if anyone is considering of buying a Land Rover because of that, you can go on the media side of Land Rover and download it. If you didn't spend your money on the ticket for the galactic spaceship.
Sammy is my family dog, our golden retriever. And it was really important Sammy. For us at Land Rover to design our vehicles with our dogs in mind. We've really maximised the space within the new Discovery. We've also got a functional which allows the back end of the vehicle to drop down for an easier access for the optimum height for the dog to enter the vehicle. So we took Sammy and we created a CAD virtual model of him, and we used him to design and engineer the new boot space for the new Discovery. So Sammy will be really happy within the interior boot space of the new Discovery because he'll have the freedom to move around and really enjoy and be comfortable within his journey.
So happy.
Yeah. A lot of the engineering teams actually own dogs, so we took that mindset when we started to engineer and design the new Discovery space so that it really worked for dog-owning families.
Oh, happy, happy Sam, Sammy. So the agency really made our life quite easy because they only used locked cameras and gave us the camera data sheet, so we knew which lens was on it, and then we kind of like just eye matched it into position. We already had the car as a geometry for other assets, so it was quite straightforward of bringing it into place, knowing where about we have to move. One tricky thing about it was that Land Rover was always afraid that the dog is looking too big in the back of the boot. So for everyone, like, this Discovery is a massive car, but still the dog was so big that it kind of like felt like that it was kind of a bit squeezed in, especially because of the wide lens camera. So once we finished, they said like, oh yeah, movement, everything is great, but just make the dog smaller. And we made it, all right, well, we matched it to the real dog, but we made it a bit smaller, sent it over, and they're like, oh yeah, just make it even more smaller. So it was like shrinking the dog a few times till they were happy in the dog. And it's like we were at one point like, well, just make the car bigger if it's not working out for you. But anyway, yeah, probably easier to, yeah, shrink the dog. So there he is, laying down. In terms of for the rigging, we used 3D Studio Max CAD rig for it. It is based on, I think I used a Panther. That was like the closest to the dog I found in the preset list, and it worked quite well. So yeah, nice project, quick turnaround. We only had a couple of days doing it, and it was good fun. So yeah, that's already it from our side. Merci, thank you. I'm not sure if we have time for questions, like maybe one or two, if someone wants to know something. If not, like we will be here still standing around for a while, so you can come up to Dave or Carmen, the technical director, or to me. And yeah, like Dave mentioned earlier, we're always up for collaborations or kind of finding new talents. So if you like what you saw and thought, I think, yeah, that would be good fun to work with us. Yeah, let us know.
I think we have 10 minutes, so yeah.
Does anyone want to know something?
Great. Okay. Cool. Well, like, just going back to what Mike said, we are looking for, we're always looking for artists, people that are passionate about the things we're passionate about. I know ArtRay are also, they're also looking for artists, so whether you want to be in London or whether you want to be in Sofia, come and speak to me or speak to Paul from ArtRay. She's here, Paul Yanni. And yeah, if come and introduce yourselves, grab a card, and don't be shy.
Oh, we've got one question over there.
Thank you, guys.
There's one guy who wants to know something.
Yeah, my mic stopped working.
You have to scream out really loud.
Yeah. How long does it take you to model a car?
From scratch. Well, what we normally get is, like, for those kind of projects, we get the data from Land Rover directly, and then it's more like about prepping the cars, getting everything clean and getting the detail in if there's something missing, and that's normally a couple of days, depending on which, if it's interior, exterior, probably like a week of prepping. But if you would build it from scratch, that would be quite a bit of work. It's really impressive how much detail is on a car. Like everyone knows, oh, it's a bunch of parts, but once you get the data in, it's like a few gigabyte of just data, and it's so, then you understand why they're so expensive in general, because it's just too many parts on it.
But the data tends to be in pieces, so as Mike was saying about the prep, is a case of kind of conforming all the geometry together and methodically going through it, because we don't have all the data in there. Then on the soft surfaces, such as the seats and the leather, they normally have to be remodeled. Because they come out as a hard surface. So things like stitching, extra details like creases in the leather, that all then has to be actually modeled from us and approved from the client.
I think it's also about what's worth mentioning is like what we normally try is like, because it's so much work and time which goes into prepping it really well, we first try to figure out which areas we were going to see and how close up we are on it. So if we are really kind of passing a seat and you really see each single stitch, we need to put much more effort in as if it's like a wide top shot or something. So it's like first figuring out what you're going to see in the film and then kind of like going in and adding as much detail as possible. Anyone else? All right.
Cool.
I think the time is up.
Thanks.
Thanks a lot. Thanks.